Hello, my name is Art Richardson. Welcome to the Sunday morning service for Victorville United Methodist Church and the First United Methodist Mission of Barstow. We're glad that you could spend some time with us, and we pray that you are well and would like to encourage you to share this video with anyone who does not have easy access to it. You can find all of our videos on our Facebook page, United Methodist Church of Victorville, or on our YouTube channel, Victorville United Methodist. You can also find our service in audio form by calling 760-245-2529, and God bless you.
Turning and returning, we come to worship God. Turning and returning, Jesus transforms our world. We come to Christ's presence, ready to be transformed.
Today's scripture reading comes from Matthew 6, 1-6, and 16-21. Be careful not to practice your righteousness in front of others, to be seen by them. If you do, you will not have a reward from your Father in heaven. So when you give up to the needy, do not announce it with trumpets, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and on the streets, to be honored by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. And when we pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues or on the street corners to be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you pray, go into your room, close your door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. And then 16-21. When you fast, do not look somber as the hypocrites do, for they distinguish their faces to show others that they are fasting. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face, so that it will not be obvious to others that you are fasting, but only to your Father who is unseen, and to your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. Do not store up in for yourselves treasures on earth, where the moths and vermin destroy, and where the thieves break in and steal. But store up yourselves your treasures in heaven, where moths and vermin do not destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will also be. The word of God for the people of God. Praise be to God.
Good morning. Today's message comes to you from Victorville United Methodist Church. Today marks the halfway point in our Lenten journey. As we gather this morning on the third Sunday of Lent, I would like to begin by taking just a moment for us to be reminded of what Lent is all about. I want to do this not only because we are halfway through the Lenten season, but also because this morning's passage from the Sermon on the Mount really strikes at the heart of what Lent is all about. If you remember, Lent is a time of preparation, the 40 days, excluding Easter, when we empty ourselves of the old, the dirty, the bad, so that we can take on the new life that is made possible through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, which we celebrate every year at Easter. In and of itself, Lent is a very important time of the Christian year, and also an important time for the life of the believers. The problem, though, is that we have a tendency to contain this season to just 6 weeks of doing good, rather than building a Lent that becomes a way of life. And that's why this passage from the Sermon on the Mount and all the Sermon on the Mount and all of the Sermon on the Mount really is so important. Just when Jesus stood on the mountainside and taught the disciples and the crowds, he was directing them on a way of preparation for new life with God. In other words, he was teaching about a whole new way of life. You know, we really do miss the point about Lent. In fact, in recent decades, I think we've made Lent so much about what we give up that we forget the why behind those practices. I heard about a teenager that was on the first Sunday of Lent, came home from church, and while she was eating her lunch, she told her father and mother about how they talked in Sunday school about what they were going to give up for Lent. So her father and mother asked her if she was going to give something up, and she said yes, junk food. So then the father asked, junk food? Well, what does that mean? Is it like desserts or what? Well, she explained that it was all junk food, like pizzas and desserts and bad things. And sure enough, she finished her lunch, and without a word, she went about playing, no request for dessert or anything. But then that evening, when dinner was finished, she asked her mother what was for dessert. And her mother said, but you gave up junk food for Lent. She says, no, that's not what I said. And her mother said, well, that's what you told me and Daddy at lunch. Then she went on to explain to her mother that what she actually gave up was some junk food. About that time, her father walked into the room and she asked for some dessert. He engaged her in the very same conversation her mother had just had with her. In the end, she had dessert. And that bit about giving up junk food for Lent was completely forgotten. Does that sound familiar to any of you? We give up things for Lent because that's the appropriate thing to do. And maybe we do a little better than the teenager did in sticking to our covenant for the 40 days. But then when Easter comes, we congratulate ourselves, move on with our lives, and it turns out that practice didn't make a difference. Obviously, these practices, as a general rule, do not have any profound and lasting impact on our lives. When Jesus was preaching his Sermon on the Mount, he knew that there were some important practices that could change our lives, our life together, and our life with God. And that's why he begins this second part of the sermon with a lesson about the importance of giving, praying, and fasting. It turns out that most Jews in Jesus' day were faithful in their giving, praying, and fasting. The problem, though, was that they engaged these practices for selfish purposes, so that they would appear faithful and pious, so that people would know they were good people, and on and on. And the point Jesus wants to drive home in our passage this morning is not so much the importance of giving, praying, and fasting, but the fact that these practices are to truly have a profound and lasting impact on our lives. Then not only must they be engaged regularly, but they must always be entered into reverently and humbly, and with all focus on God and God alone. We are going to spend some time thinking about the attitude in which we engage these practices about which Jesus is teaching. But first, I want us to consider for a moment, why is it important to engage the spiritual disciplines like giving, praying, and fasting on a regular basis? A few years ago, a book came out entitled My Year of Living Biblically. The author, a gentleman by the name of A.J. Jacobs, is an agnostic, and he made that decision that for one full year, he would follow every single rule in the Bible as literally as possible. His book, obviously, is an account of his experience. The year-long experiment did not result in a radical conversion for Jacobs. However, Jacobs did acknowledge near the end of the book that his engagement with these biblical and spiritual disciplines brought about in Jacob's life an openness to faith that had not existed before. I share this story with you in order to say this. Spiritual disciplines, and in particular, those addressed by Jesus in our reading this morning, really do change our lives and direct our hearts towards God. Giving, praying, and fasting help us to seek to be open and responsive to God. Remember, Jesus came in order to make possible for humanity a new relationship with God. And what Jesus is teaching us in our passage for this morning is how to grow in the relationship that he has made possible for us. But the thing of it is, we can't just give, pray, and fast and expect that automatically our relationship with God will grow. That's the other lesson Jesus is teaching here this morning. We have to enter these disciplines with the right heart. Ultimately, it's at the very core of what this is all about. Jesus is challenging his listeners to confront what and whom they worship. And are they worshiping themselves, something else, or the living God? Because so often, Jesus sees these people shouting their prayers from the rooftops or rattling their coins in the offering plate, and he knows they are not worshiping and praising God. They are worshiping and praising themselves. The problem here, as we can all guess, is that such practices do nothing to draw us into God's presence. In fact, they may even separate us from God. I am sure there is not a single one of us here who wishes to separate ourselves from God. At least I hope not. So we would do well to heed Jesus' teachings this morning. The life that truly is life, the Lenten life, is one that chooses the way to humanity. The way that puts all aside everything and focuses all of our attentions and all of our resources towards God. The way of humility is one in which we empty ourselves every day, not just during the season of Lent, so that we can be filled with God's goodness. So, what are the keys to this way of humility, the way of life that Jesus would have us follow? The first key is getting our priorities straight. Like so much in our lives, this is much easier said than done. We can have good priorities and good intentions, but then when it comes to the actual practice, a little voice in the back of our minds gets the best of us. We give ourselves a little pat on the back and think to ourselves, well, I'm really quite the model Christian. I did my devotions every morning this week. Or we drop our tithe into the offering plate as it passes by and then immediately go about judging the person sitting next to us who put nothing in there. But the thing of it is, the ways we serve God should give glory to God, not to ourselves. When it comes to growing in our relationship with God, it is only God that matters, not ourselves and not anyone else. Which leads us to the second important key to this way of life that Jesus is teaching about, and that is to learn to live in the presence of the loving Father. In other words, our priority must be God at all times and in all places so that we can learn to live in God's presence every day. And to truly live in God's presence, we have to reject the cheap thrill of accumulating empty praise, fleeting recognition, and flimsy relationships in order to embrace the one relationship that really matters. We have to monitor ourselves so that we do not drift into an unhealthy righteousness like that which Jesus described, practices which look good, but which have absolutely no substance. The simple truth of the matter is that if our life and the way we live it is about anything other than God, then our priorities are off, and we are the only ones who can get things back in focus. Are you truly humble? Jesus has laid the path out for us, but it's up to us to stay on track. Jesus teaches a lot in this section of his sermon. There can be no question about that. I very easily could preach three different sermons about what he teaches us here about giving, praying, and fasting. But what I want us to hear today is that these practices and all practices in the life of faith are completely meaningless if the motivation and the priorities are wrong. So here's my challenge to you this Lent. Don't worry so much about the junk food or the TV or staying off Facebook. Instead, take the next 20 days to get your priorities straight. Do everything you can to push aside the selfish motivations that drive your actions. Take time to consider these things in your life that take precedence over your relationship with God. Practice praying in secret. Perhaps God will open your eyes to how certain habits in your life need to change, even as you are practicing drawing into his presence. Whatever it takes to get the focus off of yourself and onto God, work on it in this special season of preparation. Do these things now so that when Easter comes, You are truly prepared for a fresh beginning and the life that is truly life. Amen.
Let us pray. Even if we're not ready to be transformed, we come into your presence, O God. Welcome us, even as we welcome you. Reside with us and in us as we worship and honor you. Amen.
Oh, Welcome. Welcome to this time of Holy Communion. I would ask you to find some food, some bread or crackers or something to eat and something to drink. And you may want to put it on pause and then come back so that we can share this time of Holy Communion together. God will bless all that we have to share, the food and the drink that we have to share, in Christ's name. May the God of holy words be with you.
May the meditation of our hearts be with you.
People of God, open yourselves to the one who is your rock.
God fills us with foolishness so that we may be wise.
Children of God, sing songs of thanksgiving with all creation.
Our voices are lifted to the one who makes all things.
You spoke those words of creation, God of faithfulness, and set the sun to run its daily course. Filled the seas with imaginative creatures, planted fruits and vegetables in the earth. All that is good and generous was intended for your children, shaped in your image. But we bore false witness against you, honoring sin and death more than you. The prophets came to warn against our foolishness, but we did not find their words acceptable and continued to covet everything which did not belong to us. So you sent your child to us, so we might find strength in his weakness, we might find glory through his humiliation. With those who have great faith, with those who have very little, we sing our thanksgiving to you.
Holy, holy, holy are you, God of mountaintops. The heavens join all creation to tell of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who is foolish for our sake. Hosanna in the highest.
Day to day, you are holy, our God, and Jesus Christ declares your wisdom to us. The word of your mouth, he came to tell us of your work of grace and hope. The meditation of your heart, he came to quiet our frantic spirits so we might rest in you. Your foolishness, he was wise enough to take our sins to the cross. Your weakness, he was strong enough to endure death for us until you brought him out of the grave. As we remember his zeal for your heart, as we remember his passion for us, we would speak of that mystery we know as faith.
Christ died, the rock which broke sin's power. Christ was raised, death conquered by our Redeemer. Christ will return, desiring us more than anything in all creation.
Here, at this table, God of love, we set aside our power to feast on the weakness found in the broken bread. We let go of our wisdom to drink from the cup of your foolish grace. Your Spirit blesses these gifts as well as us, so that when we have feasted, we will look at the world with its injustices, oppressions, wars, and fears, saying, take these things out of here. Stop making God's creation a house of horrors. And when the sun has finished its course, when the moon and stars shine no more, we will be given the words from your mouth, so we can sing from the depths of our hearts to you, God in community, holy in one. Amen.
Body of Christ, broken for you. The blood of Christ, shed for you.
the body of Christ broken for you, the blood of Christ shed for you. Gracious God Almighty, we thank you for this gift that nourishes our soul. We ask that you empower us to be the disciples that you want us to be. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. God speaks and sends us forth.
We will go to proclaim God's grace and glory.
Jesus speaks and lives are changed.
We will go to set free the oppressed, to be the voice for those never heard.
The Spirit speaks and the world is turned inside out.
We will become as foolish as a trusting child, as powerless as those overlooked by everyone around them.
And now, in the name of an almighty God, we ask his blessings on you. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, go and be at peace. Amen.
Thank you for being with us throughout this service. We hope that you were able to find it inspiring. If you would like to make a donation, you can mail it to our church address at 1515 La Paz Drive, Victorville, California, 92395, or 404 East Mountain View Street, Barstow, California, 92311. You can also make an online donation through our church website, churchonlapaz.com, or vvumc.org. Remember, you can also listen to our service by calling 760-245-2529. We thank you for any help that you can provide as we are trying to do the best that we can in these trying times. Until next time, God bless you.